Bear with me a moment, guys. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Sonal. What happened there? Can someone help me with that?
You exit the software.
Oh, did I? I'm sorry. No, just this one. Just the right one, yeah. So while this loads up, I'll get started. Hi, everyone. I'm Sonal. I'm an ex-entrepreneur, a passionate marketer. I currently work with PayPal. I've worked in the banking space, in the stockbroking space, and in the SaaS space. One of the things that I've learned, and I think a value that's very important to me from my entrepreneurship experience today, and I think it's one of the most valuable currencies when it comes to success, is hustle. Everything that we do from a marketing, sales, business perspective needs us to hustle. Our customers are changing, the environment is changing, everything is so dynamic. A lot of my deck is actually me hustling the very last minute to put it together. But I want to kind of keep this conversation interactive. Pardon my sore voice, the haze has not been particularly kind to me. So what I was thinking is, while we go through the conversation, while we go through the tactics that you could really go back to work tonight and actually implement in your campaigns, maybe you can stop me while we are going through the deck, ask me questions, just raise your hand. That way it'll give me a break to grab a drink to maybe clear my throat a little bit. Does that sound all right? Cool. I think all of us must be aware of this. We've gone through this or going through this. Marketing has changed. It's continuously evolving. It's really moved from being a very right-brained, sort of artistic center about, telling stories, to the super left brain looking at, a lot of data to customize, to optimize. But now to coming to a balance, coming to a fine balance between the two, a good combination where we still want to tell really compelling stories. And from my previous speaker's perspective, yes, create awesome conversations, but conversations that drive results for the business, that drive revenue, if that's the goal, drive new customers, if that's the goal. But that's really the balance that we're all striving to achieve in this particular room. We want to drive, the revenue, the business goals, by running super personalized, super relevant campaigns to our final target audience. And I think one of the top goals that most marketers are given is, hey, I want to acquire more and more customers at the least possible cost. Nobody wants to pay an increasing cost of acquisition as your business matures over a period of time. You want to get better at doing it. You want to get more and more efficient at doing it, which in itself is a fantastic goal. There's nothing wrong with it. It's absolutely the right thing to go after. But even the most seasoned marketers amongst us, some of the smartest minds, I think we all get a little bit myopic. We'll all end up going after the lowest hanging fruit, the easiest to reach out to customer. You take the super short term view saying, hey, how do I meet my target for the next month, next quarter, next year? And we tend to lose focus and tend to lose sight of the real long term. Challenges that this approach brings? A super leaky funnel. You've spent all the money, all your marketing resource, not just your dollars, but your time. You've worked with your creative team, you've worked with your sales team to bring this customer in, but the customer transacts only once. Or they don't transact at all. Or they transact a couple of times, they churn. Worst, what happens is your cost to service them keeps increasing. You're going to keep reaching out to them with more promotions, more sales material. You'll have customer service going out, but you're still not able to get them to transact often with you. And pretty much no company wants a one-time customer. You want them to buy over and over again, or if you're a subscription service, you want them to subscribe to your service every quarter, every year, every 3 years. This brings me to my topic on how can you use LTV to play the long game in acquisition. Most of my conversation is focused on tactics, on what can you do today or tomorrow with any part of your marketing toolkit. I'll start with a very simple definition of lifetime value or customer lifetime value. Very, very simply put, this is the average value of a transaction, the number of transactions a customer may have with you every year, and on an average, how many years the customer stays on your book or tends to keep transacting with you. Of course, there is a big debate on this, whether should your transaction value include your revenue or just your profit or your EBIT, but I think that conversation is for another day, for another forum, because I don't think anybody in the world agrees to what the right calculation is. But broadly, you're going to think about how much money am I making per customer, because finally we are all here to turn a profit, turn positive from a marketing ROI standpoint. The next piece of this is your customer acquisition cost. Very straightforward. Your marketing expenses divided by the total number of customers that you've acquired in a particular period. Again, here, as the marketing practice advances, the conversation moves from, hey, should I just consider my media cost, or should I also consider my non-working cost? So let's say my production cost or my employee cost. Next, people will start thinking about, hey, do I need to also buffer in my costs of bonuses, my employee retention, et cetera. But it's really up to the maturity of the company on what you want to consider as your CAC. But a very broad guideline is to go after your base level media spend or your marketing budget and say, okay, I spend $100, I acquire 10 customers, my CAC is $10, give or take. And there is a golden ratio actually between the CAC and LTV. For every dollar that you spend on marketing, you should at least ideally make $3 back. That's when it really starts to add up, to stack up, and you're making a sizable impact to the top line or the bottom line of your company. So this is called the golden ratio. You have SaaS companies and startups who follow this kind of a guideline, and when they are going out to raise funds, this is one of the key metrics that investors and angels would look at to see, hey, what is sort of your CAC and LTV ratio. There are some companies who might hit a 1:5, which is a great ratio, but if you're hitting something like a 1:10, then you're probably not reinvesting enough in marketing, in sales, and in increasing your customer base. So it's really about finding a good balance between your cost and the revenue or the profit you're generating for your business. This is a dated example, but I've pulled this out here only as an illustration. Most of us, just show of hands, do people use Amazon here? Amazon Prime? There, I see a couple of hands going up. Amazon Prime, for the company, actually has a very significantly high LTV. It's almost 3 times the LTV of a non-member. Of course, this is 2015 data, so I'm sure it's changed, but I'm going after something that's publicly available. Now, if you look at the number of subscribers they have on Prime and the cost to acquire a Prime subscriber or to even convert someone from a regular account to a Prime account, there are significant marketing and service costs associated. However, on an average, a Prime customer spends 2.5 times more than a non-Prime customer. So when you just stack it up, you already know that the value of a Prime customer is far higher. Now, when you look at this in a perspective of the lifetime value of a customer, how many years will a Prime member stay on with you? Now, let's say for Amazon in US, they've acquired a 30 or a 25-year-old customer. It's likely that the customer will stay with them for the next 25 to 30 years. Because if you look at the engagement rates with Amazon, the average transaction value and the number of transactions, they've been growing continuously. If you put all of this into perspective, you definitely see that the Prime member is far more valuable to Amazon than a non-Prime guy. This should be a good indicator for a marketer to notice that if the value of a type of a customer is significantly higher, I should be willing to spend that percentage higher money to acquire them, to nurture them, to keep them in the funnel, and to keep them engaged. Yeah, make sense? Okay. So this was just to kind of set the stage on what LTV is, what CAC is, and how do you how are companies using to balance this? Another really famous case study is Dollar Shave Club. You know, that's a subscription-based company, which is, you know, a couple of dollars for a razor subscription for guys every month. But how that plays out for them and how much money they've spent on actually acquiring a customer, and then what is the retention rate? You might really enjoy, you know, looking that one up. That's a pretty interesting one. Moving on to, okay, this is great theory, this sounds interesting, but hey, Sonal, what am I going to do with this tomorrow when I go back to work? And when I saw your slide earlier, when you said, hey, chuck the funnel and let's go after the flywheel, I was like, okay, yes, I agree. I think the flywheel concept is extremely, extremely important. In fact, in some of the largest companies, whether you look at Amazon, whether it's Ali, they rely on the flywheel. They're not going to go and acquire every single direct customer. They want to try and acquire a lead customer or a lead merchant, which will bring them the few next 100,000 consumers. So the flywheel effect is very, very important in all of these industries. But to make this sort of this session more, you know, tactical, the approach I've taken is, hey, you want to start looking at your acquisition mix. You want to start looking at how do I improve, you know, the efficiency of my programs, but how do I also make sure that I'm getting the right kind of customers? So the first step I would recommend is draw out your customer journey. What's their decision-making journey, and then map out what your funnel looks like, right? Very standard, somebody doesn't know you, so you want to get them to know you first. At that stage, you are demonstrating expertise. At the next stage, you want them to really get to like you and to trust you and say, hey, okay, you know, you guys are right for me, so I'm going to consider buying you guys. That's when you reveal your values, you reveal your value proposition, and, you know, he spoke about the conversation piece in great detail, so I'm going to stay away from that. We spoke about narrative in the previous session, which I think will really add a lot of value in some of these tactics that I'm going to talk about. And the last piece is really you want that customer to trust you, because finally when somebody's putting their dollar on the table for you to take, they're essentially saying I'm you know, placing my trust in you, so you please deliver a good product or a good service to me. So that's broadly what your funnel looks like. What you see on the right hand side is your marketing toolkit. What I will call out, and this was a very interesting study by Google recently, that the funnel itself, the stages in the funnel, so your awareness, interest, consideration, et cetera, the stages are very hazy. People don't necessarily make a decision like this. People will become aware of you, they'll be interested in you, they'll research you, they'll forget about you, they'll read about a competitor later, then they'll decide to, you know, research about you a little bit more. So everything is very hazy. But the really interesting metrics to keep in mind is a single purchase decision or a single transaction actually generates 40 organic searches on Google and 125 digital touch points. So as a marketer, if you just let that number sink in, you have 125 opportunities to reach out to a prospect before they make a decision to buy you. And when you're reaching out to them, you're not the only ones who are reaching out to them. You have all your competitors, plus you have a whole ton of noise, plus you have all their trusted sources, which could be you know, through their social networks, through their conversations, which might be offline, that they're making that decision. So you should definitely keep something like that in mind, that even when it comes to your decision on what channel, what kind of attribution, you have to keep in mind that that whole last click attribution is, well, I want to say dying, but it's actually dead. Your first click is also dead. You're looking at a multi-touch attribution. You want to assign value to every interaction that you're building for your customer, because every interaction is moving them down further in the journey to decide that, hey, yes, I want to transact with this particular company. What you see on the right-hand side is your toolkit. So very standard, you'll see display, search, video, social, retargeting. You'll also see lead gen and lead nurture. You know, Tony discussed this quite a bit in detail on his topic. You'll see push notifications, so APNs and BPNs. You'll see influencer marketing, which is becoming, well, it's been going up and down in phases. It was really big. Now there's a lot of questions on how do you measure effectiveness of this channel. You'll see retargeting, you'll see SMS, you'll see content marketing. So as a marketer, you have like 30 or 40 things to choose from. And I don't know any marketer who doesn't have a resource or a budget constraint. All of us would love more money, but we don't necessarily have that luxury. So it's really about figuring out, hey, what's the right mix for me? What's the right tools for me to use to go out to my final customer? Now, typically, you would not do something only in one part of the funnel. If you were to only focus on the funnel when it comes to the evaluation and decision phase, you're only going after your lowest hanging fruit. You're only going after customers who know you, well, prospects who know you, who are interested in you. But you're not building for the long term. But if you were to only build for the long term, you're not going to have a job 2 months later because your company's not making money. So it's really about striking a balance between these different parts of the funnel and running activity across the entire funnel. And that's why you'll see SEO and content marketing are things which you'll see across the funnel. These are foundational to success. So let's say if you had $0, everything got taken away for whichever reason, you would still continue doing these two. Because this is really the heart of how people discover you and find you. And this is how people would really believe the story you're telling. I'm going to now move into a little bit of the tactics, and I think this would be a good point to, start raising your hand and asking me a question if you have any, because I'm trying to get a little bit into the actions that you could take from a day-to-day perspective. I'll start with SEM. I think most of us use this channel. It's, you know, Google AdWords, or if you're doing anything on Bing or, you know, Yahoo or whichever, search engine you choose, most of us would be doing this. Typically, most of us would be optimizing for clicks, for highest click-through rate. You want to reduce your cost per click, you want to reduce your cost per conversion, and you would typically bid on your cheapest keyword because you want to get the volume. However, if you add an LTV lens to something like this, how do you make this valuable today? Look at the box on the right. Think about optimizing your campaigns for revenue. Now, Google has an Google AdWords, or whether you're using Search Ads 360 or whichever other platform you may be using, you have an opportunity to pass on your data. You can either pass on your transaction data or you can pass on your revenue data. Easier said than done. Most companies will have privacy-related concerns on this. Nobody will want to pass on data. That's all right, too. There's another way to work with it. Most companies will have some kind of a customer management platform or a customer data platform or some kind of a lead management service, even if it's very, very rudimentary. You can pass Google's data in-house. So what you would be able to tell is, hey, you know, the click happened on this keyword, and you can pass that internally to your database. Externally, what you're doing is, this is the, you know, on the platform, this is the click data. You're going to pass on your most important metric. It could be revenue, it could be transactions. In case of PayPal, we don't pass on this kind of information, but we do the closest proxy. So you find the proxy which is relevant to your business. When I say proxy, I mean it, a metric which you see hitting a green light and you know that, yes, this is a good quality customer. And whatever that metric might be, it could be addition to cart for an e-commerce player. In case of PayPal, it's something like a predicted value, which is not the actual value of the customer. So you figure out what this metric is. But you pass that back on and start optimizing for that final number. Initially, what you're very likely to see is your cost will go high. But don't take your foot off the pedal on that one yet, because over a period of time, you will see that the revenue you're generating keeps increasing. And when I say over a period of time, this is nothing over your average sales cycle. So assuming somebody, if you're an e-commerce company and somebody adds something to your to the cart, if your normal transaction time to convert is 1 day, you will start seeing this impacting in 1 or 2 days itself. So you're not going to wait for 6 months for this number to appear. But broadly, the strategy says that don't optimize for the lowest cost. Don't optimize for the highest position. Don't optimize for a position over your competitors. optimize those keywords, use those bidding strategies, which will help you maximize your revenue or your transactions. You could also actually begin to calculate revenue per every keyword that you're bidding on. And I'm telling you, this is an eye-opener. Most of us have very complicated search accounts with hundreds of thousands of keywords. You're focusing on the long tail, which is actually the right thing to do. But you need to have an 80-20 principle. You're not going to put all your money on the really expensive and the really long tail keywords. You want to find a balance between driving revenue, driving value. And then what you end up doing, maybe in a few months, is you start bidding for your most profitable keywords, rather than bidding for the keywords which are getting you most clicks. Yeah, sort of makes sense? Go for it.
She's gonna give him the box. Oh, me to it.
Thank you. So Sonal, you said like, no, we should focus, sorry, first of all, I should introduce myself. I'm Sanjeev from American Express, India.
Hey.
So one of the key thing which we keep in mind is like, no, not only just focus on the high revenue generating keywords, but also have a long tail keywords,
yeah.
Right? So we also try to assess the halo impact of those keywords, across channels or within the channel itself,
yeah.
Right? So what is your thought around that? Because in halo impact, you cannot actually judge the revenue, but essentially it is there, right? And then it comes to the same point, how do we calculate the revenue for those scenarios?
Yeah. That's a really good point. From my experience, what I have learned is SEM is typically the very bottom of the funnel, especially if you're doing branded or competitor terms. Somebody's already made a decision about buying your particular industry or your product or your service. At that point, it should be fairly easy to figure out what are your top keywords that bring you the traffic, that bring you the halo. I'm assuming when you say halo is halo to other channels or halo to other customer segments.
Yes.
Right. So you'll be able to tell that straight away from your existing campaigns. What this approach does is, from those keywords that you identify as these are my most valuable from a halo perspective, how do you further optimize and say that I'm going to put in my resources in these top 10 keywords because they bring me the most valuable customer.
Yeah, sure.
So that's really the approach. Typically, it'll never be an either or, but it'll be about pushing the boundaries a little bit more on moving away from driving just volume to beginning to drive value in every channel that you're using. Make sense?
Okay.
I'll move on to display, and let me just have a look at okay. So display typically, we've traditionally gone after demographics, gone after interest. Also psychographics in certain industries work really well. Typically optimizing for CPM, CPC, I have not added this in, but sometimes CAC as well, right? You are optimizing for conversion driven out of display or social, etc. But if you were to add an LTV lens to something like this, start looking at affinities. Start looking, and you can create custom affinities. Both Google and Facebook allow you to do this on platform. There are multiple third-party providers that allow you to do this. But start looking at affinity. Start looking at intent. That itself will give you your higher value customer upfront. But the real magic that happens is if you start looking at your own base of customers and start pulling in insights from there. I think as marketers, we tend to be a little bit siloed. Hey, I do acquisition, so this is the part I'm going to focus on. Somebody else does engagement, so they'll focus on that piece. But we tend to forget to take learnings from our existing base and bring them back to the top of the funnel for acquisition. One of the tactics that I recommend, and we've tested this in PayPal, is lookalikes. This is very, very straightforward. From your existing database, you know who your most valuable customers are. And value could be defined as revenue, transaction, whatever metric is important to you as a business in that particular period. It's a very simple concept, which is really about playing with the audience that you're going after, but you use those customers as your base, you pick out their profiles, their characteristics, and you start using all of those in all your prospecting campaigns, in all your targeting. And then you do lookalikes of your customer base and similar audiences in Google and Facebook. And I'll show you a slide next on you know, some success we had at PayPal with something like this. And the other thing is, a lot of us, when we have agencies running our campaigns, we tend to optimize based on, you know, the lowest cost, highest conversion rate. And every time we bring in a new campaign every quarter or every month, we tend to sort of set the ball rolling right from scratch. But one of the approaches which has been quite successful for us is you pick your top performing campaign of a year ago and try and identify the parameters that made it successful from an audience targeting perspective, and start using those audiences in your new campaigns. What you will realize is, because you're running a continuous campaign, the machine gets smarter and smarter and helps you target a lot tighter. So we ran this at PayPal, very straightforward. I'm on the B2B side. Our hypothesis was, if we target audiences similar in profile to our current high-value businesses, we'll be able to acquire many more such high-value businesses. So not just the volume, but also the people we'll acquire will be much higher than value. So in PayPal, we are essentially measuring two things. If we get 100 customers in, how many of them are actually high value to us? So when we say high value, how many of them are actually resulting in 70 to 80% of the revenue to the firm? And what is their CV? So customer value is a metric that PayPal uses, which is essentially you know, the revenue minus all the costs, et cetera. And then we use something called a predicted CV, because in many cases, and especially in companies like PayPal or SaaS, or I'm guessing even financial services, because the transaction is ongoing, somebody opens a bank account with you, they're going to keep transacting over a period of 5 years, 10 years. On day one, you don't know their value. You're going to assume that it's a zero value. And this happened with us a lot in the broking business that I was a part of. That's why you build metrics like predicted CV. So you know, in general, what is the duration of, what is the lifetime of a customer that you acquire? So let's say they stay with you for 6 years. And on an average, they transact with you thrice a year. And on each transaction, you make $50. So that's how you estimate what is your predicted CV or predicted value. We ran very simple 1% and 3% lookalikes on Facebook and on similar audiences on Google, and everything else being the same. No change in creative, you know, no change in the call to action to the landing page, just purely changing the audience we went after, we saw a 10% increase in the predicted CV. And that is quite a significant number if you think about it, because you've not upped your cost at all. You've kept the same cost, you've kept the same creative, you've not invested any new resource in building a new campaign. All you've done is changed your audience. And just based on that, you're going to see revenue metrics kick in for you. This is H1 this year. Moving on to the next one, which is retargeting. This one, again, I think all of us would have heard of it multiple times. We must retarget the audience. The first touch point is not enough to convert, yada, yada, et cetera. However, except for e-commerce websites or e-commerce companies, most other companies take a very one-size-fits-all kind of approach for retargeting. Somebody's come to the website, they've not converted, let's show them a message to bring them back to the website and hope as hell, cross your fingers, and hope as hell they convert. And if they don't, we're just going to keep showing them this ad like 500 times, burn our budget, and nobody's going to convert. And I've done this in the past, I'm guilty of it as well. So move from sort of one message to a message based on their browsing behavior. Now, this necessarily isn't, so this is very easy for certain companies, or, you know, let's say content websites where you have different content buckets, or, you know, whether it's sport or whether it's politics, etc. But for a one product company, or rather, you know, like a company which functions only in one industry, imagine, you know, you were in a bank and you only had savings bank account. or current accounts. You didn't have any other products, you didn't have credit card, etc. It gets very hard to estimate what is the intent or the behavior of someone who's browsing through your website. PayPal has a similar kind of a setup. Essentially, you're a payment service provider, you're a digital wallet. You're a low interest category. Nobody gets excited about their bank or their payment service provider. You're never happy that, yeah, it's awesome. It's a commodity, let's be real about it. And I'll walk you through an example of what we did. The second piece is retarget everyone. But just make sure that you're going to retarget the right person at the right time with the right message. That is most relevant to them. And another thing that all of us do is we do single channel. You'll retarget on display. Sometimes you'll probably say, okay, I'm gonna retarget on social. But what happens to email? Why are we missing that as a channel? It works in many, many markets. What about SMS? Is there a way to do that? What about search? Why don't we retarget on search? So these are the kind of things to think about when you're building out your retargeting strategy. In my experience, retargeting would have been is usually the most effective because they're already in the funnel. They've already made a decision to consider you. So your job is to really, get them to cross over the line and say, hey, yes, I'm going to transact with you. Wow, that's really tiny. Okay. So I'll just walk you through what we did at PayPal as an idea, a thought starter. But PayPal across the markets that I manage, which are essentially Brazil, Mexico, India, China, Japan, Hong Kong, and a couple of other markets like Russia, Israel. What we realized is a bulk of the traffic that comes to the site is actually consumers. These are the people like you and I who want to use PayPal to shop online, to buy something from another country. What we were going after are actually merchants. So how do I even identify when someone comes to the PayPal website that somebody's a merchant or somebody's a consumer? So just from that very, very top level, what we did is we made a list of all the pages that we have on the website. Well, all the top traffic pages. That's your first thing. You have to look at traffic, build a list of all the pages you have, and start clustering them. The best way to do this is really to work with your sales and service team and to work with your web team, your analytics team, to identify that, hey, okay, if somebody has visited a product XYZ, what are they likely to be interested in? What is their intent? And your sales team will typically be able to tell you this quite easily, that if you're visiting this product, I'm sure they're going to, go down this funnel. So you start building that out. And you'll find commonality. You'll find, 5 or 10 pages that typically will lead to someone, buying a product. So we did that across maybe, this is a small piece, but maybe across 30 or 40 pages. And we built it out into 4 or 5 key sets. What we identified is if somebody visited, these 3 products, product pages, they were likely to be someone who was selling fashion garments on the internet. Versus somebody who visited these 5 products, it's very likely they were not selling online. They were selling B2B and probably selling via email, making a contact, off from these platforms, and then asking someone to pay them over chat or over email or over SMS. So you build out these kind of intents. Based on these intents, you come up with an ad with a relevant value prop and a relevant benefit. So for someone who's transacting online or somebody who's asking to be paid online, they are very concerned about things like fraud, because you don't want a customer to put their credit card details in and then struggle with their credit card details being stolen. Versus somebody who's a B2B seller, they're not very worried about fraud. They're actually worried about, will I get paid on time? How is PayPal going to protect me if the guy doesn't pay me back? So it's these kind of things. So you build out the relevant value props, and then you take them to the relevant landing pages. A lot of us take people back to the same site where they've bounced off. And we've done this in the past because you just don't have enough resources to create like 15 different retargeting streams. There's a hack to it. Use anchor links. Go to your same page where somebody's bounced off, but find the most relevant section, put an anchor text on that, and make sure you direct people to that relevant section. So at least that'll give them this impression of, hey, the content is fresh and it's worth coming back to this. We ran this for about 5 to 6 months, and it's still ongoing. we had 29% more high-value merchants in that period, which is a very, very significant number, simply by changing the messaging, because our audience still remained the same. We're still going after everyone who's ever visited the website. All we did is switch out our messaging. So what you'll see here is this one is a play on messaging. The previous one was a play just on audience. And one of the reasons that we've taken an approach like this is to have to keep things really simple and quick and dirty wins. So things that you could really go back and execute immediately rather than getting literally the planets and the solar system to align and 500 people to agree to what you're saying. So just these really quick tweaks and hacks in your campaigns can help you win a little bit. The next one is video. I find video the most, personally the most interesting, but also the most challenging to prove value. So very honestly, I don't have all the answers on this one. I have hypotheses and I have some case studies. But broadly, most of us use video, very top of the funnel, focus on views, probably video completions. Typically you're doing content which will, it's unskippable, so it's content that someone will lean in and watch and then wait for them to be able to, wait for you to be able to skip it because you want to get to your real content. So it's very intrusive, interruptive. What's a way to kind of run video to make sure that it's adding to the value of your marketing programs and you're able to measure it and you're able to justify the spend there? One is don't be afraid of doing a skippable ad. Ideally, if someone skips, you're not going to pay for that particular skip, right? So just run a skippable ad. YouTube has been trying to crack this model of making sure that video is considered in the overall channel mix when it comes to performance marketing. They've come up with various updates in the last few years. One of them is TrueView for Action with cards. So these are these little YouTube videos where you have at the bottom of it you have this little ad. It has a call to action. It's a text ad. It has a call to action, and when you click on it, it'll take you to the website. It'll take you to the lead form. If you're watching it on mobile, it can take you to the app. So they're trying this format. Try and create content that somebody's actually willing to watch, rather than something being intrusive, something that adds value. And I know this sounds so repetitive and really rather preachy that create valuable content, but I think it's something we forget so easily because you want to get things out of the door. As a performance marketer, you want to deliver your revenue and you don't really think about it. But create content that somebody doesn't mind watching, that wants to invest those 30 seconds or 1 minute or 2 minutes on actually watching. And then don't worry about the views so much, especially when you're thinking about how this adds to your acquisition, assuming that that's the objective of your campaign. Think about video completion. Think about website visits at the very least. If you're using the TrueView format, think about leads. Think about actual conversions, etc. I have a case study here from a company called Vola.ro. They are Romania's largest online travel agency, and they are actually amongst the fastest growing companies in Central Europe. I know it's really obscure as an example, but the reason I brought it in is to show the applicability of all of this across the globe. So it's not necessary that this will work only in certain markets, but this is working in emerging markets as well. So they ran this campaign, which was TrueView for Action. What they were looking at doing is running a video campaign to acquire more customers, to acquire more bookings. And online travel essentially works like this, right? You'll click on the ad, or you'll go to the website, and you decide to make a transaction. You decide to make a purchase then and there, assuming you've done all your comparison outside of the site, right? You've tried to find the best price. They ran this campaign for not a very long duration, but what's interesting is the outcomes. One, they used CTAs and headline and text overlays over every ad. So it wasn't a feel-good, unskippable ad. It was a very action-oriented ad, which was, hey, once you watch the ad, click here to book your ticket. They developed messages tailored for very specific audiences. So they were going after people who were looking at hotel bookings, who were looking at package bookings. So they made sure that they targeted people with similar kinds of intents on YouTube. And then they set up, you know, a conversion lift survey. Google, this kicks in, I think, over a spend of $60,000. It's anyways free for your campaign. You're looking at spending about $10K per day. And this conversion lift study helps you helps you measure what is the lift from this campaign compared to you not having run this campaign at all. So what was the additional benefit that video drove for your overall campaign? View through conversions is a very key metric in video that a lot of people sometimes miss out on because they're looking at direct clicks. People don't click on videos. People don't even click on ads, that's another thing, but especially on videos. So they started looking at view through conversions. They started looking at the bookings that they received in a short period, and that was a pretty significant number because they saw about a 7% lift in their overall conversions. I found this case study very interesting simply because, you know, they're able to measure impact on revenue directly from video. And these case studies are a little bit hard to find on which video campaign has actually driven a measurable impact to the business, to the top line. And in fact, after this campaign, video has become a part of their performance marketing stack. So every time they're running a campaign for acquisition or for transactions, they use video as one of the primary channels in addition to search and display. And I think that's a very big testimony to the fact that, hey, video actually worked for them. I'm going to save us all a little bit of time. We discussed a lot of lead nurture in the previous presentation. The only thing I will add to this, to the earlier conversation, and thankfully I've deleted my next slide because it was it would have been a repetition of what you were going through earlier. The only thing I'll add from a lifetime value perspective is we think about MQLs and SQLs. Which is a very good starting metric, and at the bare minimum, we should all be looking at it if your business indeed is a lead, sort of lead-driven business. But the thing that we all should also start considering is funnel velocity. What does funnel velocity mean, right? I think the simplest way to put this is how fast do you need to keep leads coming in, or how, what is the quantum of leads you need to keep coming in so that you meet your revenue objectives? Typically, this calculation is done with, you know, a couple of things in mind. What's my target revenue? So I want to hit $1 million, for example, right? What are the opportunities in my funnel today? I have 10,000 opportunities, for example. What's my average deal size? So every customer, my average deal is $5,000, give or take, whatever that number might be. What is your average sales cycle? So typically, if the conversion takes 6 months, you need to calculate that in all your marketing spend. And we tend not to consider things like that. And the last part is your win rate. So for every 100 leads you bring in, is your sales team converting 5 of them, 20 of them, or 50 of them? So when you start triangulating this information, and I'll just read out the formula to you. It's basically what are the opportunities in your pipeline currently, which are sales is saying, yes, this is worthy, this is something to go after, multiplied by the average win rate that the sales team usually sees, multiplied by the average deal size, so $50, $100, whatever that number might be, and the average length of the sales cycle. That will give you the number that you should go after in terms of right at the very top that I need to bring in these leads. And this is the conversion rate I need at each funnel. Because right at the beginning, you have a prospect, you have a lead, you might have a marketing qualified lead based on engagement, then you may have a product qualified lead, which you know they're eligible to be sold to, right? Like they have all the right tech set up, etc. Then you have a sales qualified lead where the sales team says, hey, I made contact, it was successful, they're interested in buying. Then you eventually have like other stages, like they're, you know, discussing integration, they're discussing pricing, etc. And then you have finally going live. So if you're looking at the funnel, there's just so many levels of decision and the leakage is so much. It's important to keep velocity as a concept at the back of your mind so that you know how much do I invest at the very top of my funnel. Because most of us will say, I need to hit 500 leads. But what you have to consider is, why do I need to hit this 500 leads? And what do I need to impact? The lead to MQL ratio and the time in which I'm able to move it to MQL will impact how many leads you bring in at what stage in the funnel. Yeah, that was a big monologue. This one is APNs and BPNs. Anybody in the room use these often? These are push notifications, app or browser. Awesome. I think the move that we all need to consider making is move from a standard push notification, one message to everybody, to something that's really valuable. This is really hard outside of a e-commerce or a transaction or a shopping-based experience. The minute you get into a more subscription-based experience, what do you send to your customers or your prospects on a daily basis or on a regular basis? So that's really challenging, and I would say that you need to refer to their intent, what made them actually download the app. So the piece of content that brought them to your site and then which led them to download the app, keep that in mind when you tailor the app notification or your browser notification. We usually think of this as an individual channel, but start looking at this as a part of your overall channel mix. So you want to make sure you're creating a consistent experience, right? If you're sending someone a notification on the app or on the browser, make sure when you do send email communication, it is aligned and it's similar. It's not some other story, another narrative, another tone of voice. You're just going to end up confusing your prospect or your user or your customer. And then make sure that you're creating content on your most valuable themes. I think I find this particularly challenging to how do you identify with your limited resources, what are my top 5 or top 10 themes to go after. And again, here I would say look at your entire buying cycle, look at your buyer journey and see what are the triggers, at what point are people dropping off, and find those points and find the content needs at those points so that people don't actually drop off from your funnel. We have an example here of a French fashion and linen company. They're actually one of the largest and the fastest growing in the world. They're called La De Route. They do fashion and they do linen. A couple of years ago, they started looking at, hey, we want to do some mobile marketing. I think that was a buzzword a few years ago. And now it's omni-channel and cross-channel, et cetera. They wanted to look at, retargeting to drive in-app sales and to drive that conversation ahead. What they started to do was very interesting. They created dynamic notifications, so it was very specific to every single user who received the notification. So it was related to either the cart that they abandoned or the content they had consumed, and you have lots of technology and software that allows you to do that today. They did also display advertising, which was dynamic, it was personalized, it was only on mobile, it was actually customized to the extent of including pictures, details, price, and in fact even names when they were advertising on their own app. So it would be, hey Sonal, this is an interesting product that you looked at, why don't you come back to the app and complete your transaction, for example. They saw results from this was phenomenal. They had the ROI from this campaign was 5 to 8x of the regular display retargeting campaigns. Their click-through rates were a lot higher because when you think about it, if somebody's taken the trouble to download your app and given you that space on their phone, they're anyways an engaged user. So if you are able to provide relevant and valuable content to them, you will see higher CTR, higher conversion rates, far better reaction rates, and even all of this will then add to revenue. And in a way, once you have your app notifications and browser notifications set up, that's amongst the most challenging pieces, this channel is almost as good as an own channel. So you're not having to spend media dollars every time you go after somebody. So your upfront investment is really high, And it's also difficult to get it set up. Plus, giving people reason to download your app or even opt in for browser push notifications. I know VPNs don't work in Singapore. Not a lot of websites use them. But I also know that VPNs work a lot in a market like India. So there is a company in India called Coupon Rani, and they do this. It's a sort of a online coupon website where they offer discounts to various gigs, various events, fashion discounts, etc. They do it really well, and it works really, really well for them. So I think considering push notifications, whether app or browser, I think it's an important part of your overall strategy, especially from a performance marketing and an acquisition standpoint, because it does become your own channel that you can then leverage at any point in time. This one is a pet peeve to many, influencer marketing. There are millions of influencers. I think everybody's an influencer thanks to Instagram. I have 200 followers, I'm an influencer. That's pretty much the state of affairs today. And I think a lot of marketers tend to be focused on reach and views. You want to go after influencers who have millions of followers. Forget the whole clickbait happening there. Forget, how they actually got those influencers, got those followers. And you typically would tend to go after the most popular influencer in your category. You're a travel website, you're going to probably go to Do You Travel. I'm just giving you an example here, but you want to go after someone who has like 5 million followers. Try to flip this approach, and I have an example actually of American Express that's done this really well in US. Tie back your influencer marketing decision to your business goal. And not a generic business goal of, hey, I want to increase revenue, but a very specific goal that that influencer can help you achieve. And I'll talk about that in Amex's case in a minute. Go after the most relevant influencer, not necessarily the most popular one. Because here you're still looking at acquiring customers who are valuable to your business, and measure purchases. Or measure something which is a business KPI rather than, reach, comments, likes, shares, and all of that. That's the only way you'll build credibility for this channel within the acquisition marketing mix. From a brand perspective, this is a great tactic. But, focusing the entire conversation on acquisition, make sure that you keep these kind of things in mind. Here's an example of Amex. In fact, this campaign won a Shorty Award. I think this was 2016 or 17. So Amex comes up with these storefront decals that they sell to small businesses. These are these little decals you see on storefronts, small businesses that Amex accepted here, or Visa, Master, or whatever that might be. They wanted to increase orders for their decals. So very specific need. I want more people in the US to order my decals because it's a monetized, it's a monetized activity. What they did is they reached out to this leading design blog called Design Sponge, and they co-created content with them. They designed decals, so Design Sponge helped them design decals that small businesses would like, because that blog focuses on design. Amex and them co-created these design decals. And they released some awesome content on this television channel called HGTV. It's owned by Discovery. They are in the home decor space. So it's a paid pay-per-view kind of a channel. And they released some content there with the host. And these are some snapshots of what the content looked like. And they ran this campaign for a period of a couple of months. The results from this was just phenomenal. They sold 400,000 units of those decals just from this particular strategy. So this is a great example of influencer marketing done right from an acquisition standpoint. And I think there's a lot for all of us to learn from something like this. How you would apply it to your industry, you'd really have to think about the area of business you are in. Who is an influencer who will actually create authentic content and not just post your ad on their, to their followers. So co-creating this authentic content, getting them involved in the entire journey can really help you move the needle there. Okay, I'm almost out of time. Content marketing, I'm going to skip through this. Essentially, you're looking at a multi-channel approach. You're looking at native advertising. You're looking at content networks. you should consider, you know, to make sure that your efforts are, you know, considered as an acquisition effort. Think about including the cost of content creation in your marketing cost and in your ROI calculation cost. You measure success by subscriptions you get, by the engagement that you get, by the value of a page. Now, Google Analytics has ways to allocate page value. Start allocating page value and measure success in that way so that you're able to justify your spends on content creation. I'm going to skip through this example. I'll just tell you which one it is. It's something called, it's from Salesforce. Salesforce in UK was really struggling with flattened demand. So no increase in search volume, no increase in organic visits to the site for months on end. And they wanted to create this big blitz that how do we get people interested? Now, if you think about Salesforce as a company, it's not a consumer company. They're selling to other marketers, to other sales teams. So just the challenges involved in that, if you just look up Salesforce content marketing blitz, you'll find the videos. I don't have time to go through them right now. So in summary, I think overall, I think we all would agree that your vanity metrics are completely out. You're not looking at views, clicks, engagement, etc. You're looking at the bare minimum, time on site on your page. You're looking at actual conversions. You are looking at the revenue driven. You're looking at transactions generated from your campaigns. So keep this in mind when you're building out your campaigns. And overall, if you think about how do I make this happen in my company today, 5 or 6 steps. One, know your customer lifetime value. This is the base. You have to figure this out with your sales team, with your customer service team, with your business team. The value of my customers is, for example, $100. Next step as a marketer, start breaking this down by channel. So what is the value of a customer you're generating through display, through search, through email, whatever your channels may be. Then start passing on data, your customer value data, either on platform or start picking out on platform data like campaign, keyword, ad group, etc. Start bringing that in your database. So at least you find a match. Start optimizing your campaigns for business metrics and not cost. Keep 1:3 in your mind. Make sure that all your endeavors are focused on achieving that number. And make sure you're collaborating downstream. My biggest learning in the last couple of years at PayPal has been that my biggest success on acquisition actually comes from working with my colleagues who focus on engagement, who focus on transactions. Because they know so much about customers, I could use all that information to drive my acquisition strategies upfront. And if you want to still push the bar even further on using LTV for your acquisition, there's lots you can do. Invest in the long term, continue building your brand, reward loyalty. And e-commerce companies, again, do this really, really well. Upsell to your existing customers. They're already sold into you. They bought into you. Easier to sell to them. Leverage your long tail. And then keep optimizing your costs. Run referral programs. Take harsh calls on cutting all campaigns which are unprofitable. Even if that means acknowledging, hey, I screwed up, do it. It'll add up in the long run. And experiment with your with new channels. Because I don't know what's the right channel mix for your business, but I know what's worked for my businesses in the past and what works currently. So I would really encourage that keep testing to find the right channel mix to hit the right CV. That's it from me. If any of you have any questions later on, I'm happy to sync up on LinkedIn or drop me a text, and I'm happy to catch up, or we can even meet outside.
Thank you very much. A wonderful presentation there, and I love those case studies as well. So a round of applause again, please, from B2B Marketing Lead for PayPal, Sonal Shah.
Thank you.
Thank you.